Hello and welcome to the Cowboy for Game Yu-Gi-Oh! Podcast YCS Sydney Special. I'm your host Jake. Today I'm joined by Ben from Nolan TTG.
It's hot and I'm not doing the zoom-ins.
Braggio.
Hey.
And Luke from Locals.
Hello.
That was loud.
So how was our YCS? Let's start with you, Luke.
No, mine was really bad. I was just unprepared due to personal issues and I just didn't do well. But I really mainly just came here just to like have a weekend away.
Yeah.
Mate, so like that was kind of like the main part. Just needed time. Yeah, just time away with mates away from work. So it was good overall in that aspect.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Perfect. Ben?
I had an alright YCS. I didn't do tremendously well, but I'm not super unhappy with the way that I performed. I started the day strong, won my way to table one, and then it just kind of fell apart from there. So look, I can't knock my YCS at all. Like, yes, if there were mistakes that I made, and ultimately what ended my tournament was me just not paying attention to time, but I can't knock it at the end of the day. I quite enjoyed my weekend, and I'm not sitting here being like salty about like, oh, I lost, I shouldn't have done this, shouldn't have that. At the end, when I lost my last and I was out, I was like, you know what, I'm fine with this. I had an enjoyable weekend. All my matches were pretty fun. I didn't play against any like shit people. Yeah, overall, had a great YCS.
Lovely. Brag.
So in the Krispy Kreme report yesterday, I was really hard on myself. I was disappointed. And I was thinking back over the matches. I finally like went back over and went, oh, hold on. Like, the misplay that I did wasn't a misplay. I was trying to play around the nip, I realised, in the moment. It's just, I got so mad at myself later in the duel that I'm like, no, there was a reason why I did it that way. And he had all the outs. So... Yeah. I just had a bad string of bad run. I probably wouldn't have gone any better if I continued on like out of that round, so eh. But yeah, it has been a good weekend. I've enjoyed myself. I like this deck, so Snake Eyes that is.
Snake Eyes and
Scraps.
Yeah.
Deck profile, come and see.
So my YCS. I came into this YCS with very low expectations. I wasn't coming in with a Snake Eyes, I just was playing what I had, so I had very low expectations of how I'd do. Granted, I didn't top, so those expectations were valid. But I kept in it for much longer than what I had thought I would. So I was playing Branded with the Puppet Lock. It might have gone better if I decided not to do that, because everyone was prepared for Puppet. But yeah, like, my matchups were fine, for the most part, my opponents were all fine, and yeah, I was only, like, officially out of it by the 8th round, so, like...
It's really good.
Yeah, I'm pretty happy.
So how's Branded today? How was Branded this weekend, Jake? You were so hard on it last weekend.
Like, it was fine.
Yeah.
It lost to exactly what I...
It sucked so much last week, and then...
But that's the thing, it lost to exactly the interactions that I thought it would.
Yeah, but after 8 rounds.
Yeah, that's really good. What was like the worst thing for Branded? Like your worst
Decks that can get one card combos and hand traps. Branded does not have any of those.
So Snake.
Yeah.
Like my very last match before I was out of it completely was my first Snake Eyes match of the entire thing, and I was effectively just a nuisance that he needed to get rid of so that he could move on. I put up very little resistance to what he was able to do. He's like, this foolishness thing, that's fine. And then I was like, I had to limp my way to a puppet lock setup for his turn. And I was like, okay, trigger the effect of Sanctify. And he's like, belt. Anyway.
Yeah, that'll do it.
Yeah. The event's otherwise been fine. And similar to Luke, I just treated this as like, it's going to be a weekend away with some card games in between. So relatively happy with how I did. Just as a quick thing before we move on to the next thing. Of all of us, we did have one top in our group. Which was Joshua Glenn on Salamine Great. You can catch his profile on Ben's profile if you haven't seen it already. And a begrudging congratulations to him. This is the first and last time I want to hear about it until next year. Thanks. Anything else we want to chat about this YCS?
Who would have thought Salamine Great would do well in this format?
A fire deck doing well in fire deck?
Yeah.
I was just like the format wasn't as bad as I thought. Like I do like the concept of the fact that it just allows more rogue, because of the whole price point of like Snake Eye. Yes, it's like really good, but the fact that people can still you know, they're not completely forced to play it. Like, because I've seen a lot of variety, all things considered. Like, if you look at the breakdown, it's what, 300, 400 players?
Yeah, just on that. So, for the event, there were 917 players, and the breakdown is as follows. We had 14% on pure Snake Eye, 12.3% on Fire King Snake Eye, 11% on Voiceless Voice, a staggering 58.6% on Branded, 48.5% on Kashtira.
What?
Hang on. Yeah, the percentage of these don't make sense, do they?
Where have you gotten this note from?
This is from Yahweh.
From Yahweh's Facebook post?
Yeah.
It's definitely the percentage of these... It's meant to be 4 point, not...
Yeah, I don't understand these percentages.
50% Branded.
Anyway, we'll just go with the numbers. We'll just go with the numbers. So 129... Snake Eyes, 113 Fire King Snake Eyes, 101 Voiceless Voice, 58. Oh, I see where I've made a mistake now.
Reading the total
Dexus percentages. 58 Branded, 48 Cash Tira, 41% Floundry, 40 Labyrinth, and then 387 other.
So, how many cash were in the room again?
50 or something.
48.
Felt like more.
I've seen a lot of cash.
It did feel like there was a lot of cash, but to Luke's point, that is traditionally the way we end up in Australia. Is like when we enter these tier zero formats, a lot of people just refuse to play it.
Yeah, I sort of did last year.
There's only so many bonfires in the country.
True.
Because I really don't blame people at all for not wanting to spend money on fire. Like, yeah, it's insanely powerful, but like I've seen a lot of videos floating around that people just kept saying it is a good format for rogue. And like, I do like that. It gave the opportunity to like, for people to just play what they're comfortable with and do well. Because I knew someone through, I think it's Jesse, our mate.
Shout out to Jesse.
His mate was playing like Horus, like it was just a pile of cards. It was like Horus, Orcus something with like Tarot Top and and I'm pretty sure he was doing quite well. I'm pretty sure he topped. I'm not 100% sure.
There was a Horus deck in top 32.
Yeah, that could have been him.
Jesse,
and then with Josh with Salad, and then I'm not exactly sure the breakdown.
We'll cover that. Locals, we'll cover that in a second.
FTK, yeah, but Horus. I think it was a solid format overall.
Yeah, like I found the whole
tier zero thing was blown out of proportion.
Yeah,
I think.
Like, I mean, people were also pretty alarmed, like, when we walked into the room and 25% of people were playing Snake Eyes in some degree. It was like, well, that's a big number for one of our YCSs. But I personally, after playing 4 mirror matches straight yesterday, like, I quite like the mirror match.
The mirror match, to me, is like, it's more enjoyable than other matchups.
Yeah, it gives me, like, Zodiac vibes, where it's like, yes, or like, everything you do is one card combo, and it's up to what the rest of your deck does to decide the match. And I quite enjoyed that.
Yeah.
I quite enjoy it.
And the deck is quite fragile when you think about it as well. So,
like, if you hand trap them a couple of times, their end board is like usually just like.
If you imperm a snake, ash, and they don't have anything else, done.
Yeah, that's where it is though. The issue is that the other four cards are going to
come back at you.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah, but then they have like 4 hand traps.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can play through the double imperm. Sometimes you can't. But most of the time, you can't.
Like, I imperm Valor, like the witch and the ash, and then they just pass. Which was like, that's just how it, this is how it is.
Yeah. Anyway, that brings us to top 32.
Yes, so we have a top 32 breakdown. Again, courtesy of Yahweh Zhang, always very helpful with these kinds of things.
Yeah,
he's
doing
the written coverage over the weekend.
Yeah,
it's not being uploaded live, sorry.
Yeah,
so it must be just like a big content dump at the end of the weekend.
Yeah. But yeah, at least someone's doing something. So
it's
thank
good
you.
To have
we have something. Up. Hooray!
Yeah.
So we have in the top 32, 11 Fire King Snake Eye, 11 pure Snake Eye.
8 pure Snake Eye.
Yes. What's Vovo? Oh, voiceless voice.
So it was 3 voiceless voice, 3 cash tier.
Correct. And then all the rest are one ofs.
No, I thought it was a 2 of in there. Unless that was cash tier that I stuffed up.
No, all the rest are one according to Yahweh.
Okay.
So we have a flu, a shark, a salad, thank you Josh, a branded, a Horus combo, a vanquished soul, and a purely.
Oh yeah, vanquished soul was Stephen.
All of those.
Stephen Medhurst topped with vanquished soul. Congratulations.
Oh, good work, Steve.
And the water, that was like the Umi control thing.
It wasn't Umi control, it was the other stuff. It was sharks.
Oh, like the...
Water disease.
Yeah.
Oh, right, yeah.
So... I was pretty proud of that guy. He was, I think, undefeated going into the final round, and he lost his final round. Yeah.
Being impressive. Like first after Swiss with water.
Yeah.
That's really good.
Yeah, you like when you do that well with a deck that is so down the meta chain, like props have to go out to you, to be honest.
I think part of his issue, like if they played the whole tournament in a day, he probably would have gone further. The fact that the players that were like looking like they were going to top on day two had the night to research what the deck does makes a huge difference.
Because there was only one more round in the Swiss, so like that just makes a big difference that it's the next day.
Still, quarter representation for Snake Eye to get top. It'd be cool to get half top.
It'd be cool to see how he placed, like if he made it to like 16 or top 8 or.
Do we know the winner's list yet? Oh, the winner. What the winner was playing? We know the winner.
We do.
The winner just happened 10 minutes ago.
The winner was Jason Wang, and he was on Pure Snake Eye.
Pure Snake Eyes. Okay, I think he beat.
Would have thought one Kong card combo and 15 other hand trap packages.
Yep.
Would do well.
I'm happy Aussie won it.
Yeah, he beat Kamal Crooks in the final. So, very nice. Quite a strong US representation or foreign representation.
Yeah.
This year?
Yeah, there was a lot this year.
There was a lot of Americans. I saw Yassine was in the room.
He was. He topped.
Yassine
topped the event.
What was he? I'm assuming.
He was on Fire King Snake Eye.
Yeah, that makes sense.
He wouldn't have traveled all this way to play something else.
No. Cyber Dragons, maybe.
Yeah.
I mean, he has made a few branded videos, so I thought he might have been
the
branded.
He makes videos for everything.
Yeah,
true. Yeah, videos are cool.
I miss when we had someone for that.
Oh, I'm sorry. My bad.
Yeah, Ben.
You can unsubscribe if you want to. Everyone else does.
Savagery.
I do miss your profile.
It has to be bots or something.
Nah. It's just, like, it's a very slow drop-off. I lose, like, 10 to 20 subs.
But who unsubscribes?
It's
so, like,
I unsubscribe from channels.
Really?
Yeah. Huh. But yeah, the venue was, of course, this venue behind us.
Yes, Accor Stadium here in Sydney.
Thank you to Accor Stadium for, I guess, putting us up again. For all of our 1 year, they've come in clutch to the Millennium Room.
Yeah.
They did indeed name the room after the YCS.
And don't forget the Legends Room.
The Legends Room for all the people that were on the bottom tables.
Yeah, they didn't want the the scrubs interfering with their eyesight. So they're like, go upstairs, be banished.
Go to the Legends Room.
I think the Legends Room should have been the top tables and then maybe work out.
I think
out
it should have been reversed.
Like, and maybe just something up there.
Because
like,
I feel like it's more of a privilege for the top tables to have a little bit more
space.
Serenity and a bit more
sunlight.
Space. And light, yeah, because they draw the curtains in the room, so it's very dark in the room. So it would have been nice to have exposure to the sunlight. But maybe the top players aren't used to that. They're used to sitting in their dungeons doing combos.
That is true.
Valid.
Anything else we want to bring up about the event?
No. I think overall it was quite enjoyable.
Yeah.
We'll probably have some more points on next week's podcast as we get more of a decompression and a breakdown.
Yeah.
We'll talk about the controversies of the event.
Water control game. We made how far you made it.
I think he lost in top 32.
Sucks, but still 32. Rather be him than
than me. all right. So we move on to some news. We start with Master Duel, as we do. So they've released an update.
Are we just a Master Duel podcast now? Are we just a Master Duel podcast now?
I'll just do a bit of it. It's fine.
News is news.
We should figure that out.
Good.
Anyway, we have our next Duelist Cup announced. The first stage of that will be beginning on March 13th, which I believe is next weekend, approximate. And then the stage two starting on the 22nd. So that's good timing for me because I have the time off to actually put some effort into it. And hopefully that's how I can get to Worlds.
Of course, you're going to go to Worlds by sweating Master Duel.
Yeah.
Good luck.
What's
cheaper
the criteria
than sweating?
What time does it start again?
Starts on the 13th.
How do you get to Worlds in Master Duel? What do you have to do?
Top the Duelist Cup. And it is pretty much like they have a 48-hour window where the stage two is up. Like, you have to get to stage two. But then, like, it's a 48-hour for stage two, and you just have to be
top
as high as possible, if not the top. Yeah.
Crazy. Or if you can go out for it, you got this.
We'll see how we go.
Well, it'll be easy. I play Master Duel as high as possible.
As well as that, we have some new assets having been released. We have a wallpaper for Red Dragon Archfiend. We have sleeves for the Bad Field spell for Tyrelement.
You didn't say Red Dragon Archfiend, right?
Archfiend.
Did they really pitch that over Perlarina, or whatever it's called?
I think they've given like the good cards of Tyrelement enough stuff. They don't need to give them more stuff. Well,
yeah,
it's nice artwork, to be fair.
Yeah.
And then they get a new pack as well. This is a secret pack, the Songstress of Sorrow Song, which is basically Visa stuff and Tier Element stuff, because they haven't had a pack for it as yet.
Oh, yeah, because I saw it go up and went, oh, they must just be like rebranding or something. So we didn't have a pack for that.
No, it was just like they had, how did they release it? I think yeah, there was an initial selection pack to get it, I think. Hadn't done a secret pack. Like, it's pretty much par for the course. They've done that a fair bit with archetypes that get released.
I wonder how heavy this podcast is impacted by the bus schedule here at Olympic Park.
It can't be any worse than the bikes.
Yeah, true. Yeah. We're just trying to make you feel more at the C4G house.
As opposed to all other rumours about Sydney, we do have public transport here.
Yeah.
It just sucks.
And there it goes.
They're also releasing the selection pack called Return of the King. So this has Red Dragon Archfiend stuff in it, obviously.
Archfiend.
Earthbound Immortal,
yep.
The new support. Tistina, for reasons I don't fully understand.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense.
Because we're just printing everything early.
What's Tistina?
Well, not everything.
What's that?
Still haven't got Chimera yet.
Ah!
Jake, what's the Tistina stuff?
That's the TCG archetype we got.
It bit me.
Oh, the flippy. Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And then in this pack as well, they have released Transaction Rollback.
Fun.
Just all the stuff except for the stuff he wants.
And no bonfire.
At this point, I don't even care anymore.
Well, they release Snake Eyes off, like, full power?
Everything except for bonfires.
And Rollback.
And Raging Phoenix.
And, yeah, Raging
Phoenix. Which is actually kind of big.
Yeah, they can't OTK.
Oh, yeah.
You have to mix it with other things that can do damage.
And you can't extend with bonfire.
Yeah, to that point, they've been using cash, from what I've seen, just to put another body on the board.
That makes sense. I've been using Infernoid.
Is Rescue still like everywhere in Master Duel?
No, it doesn't exist.
No,
people don't play because they're
they haven't released Preventer and...
Preventer and Emergency aren't released on Master Duel yet.
Yep.
Oh, what?
We're getting Transaction Rollback before Emergency.
Before like a...
We're getting that before cards we haven't had...
Their release schedule is really weird now.
Yeah, they've given up.
Yeah, they just do what...
I really thought they were doing it in release of the main sets
they were.
We get.
And then they stopped doing that.
That's how it started.
I think it's just to make money because the new Snake Eyes are so popular, so they're like, here you go.
I think it gives them an excuse to hit Snake Eyes before they release the rest of the stuff that Snake Eyes breaks.
Again, this is kind of par for the course at the moment. They did similar with other archetypes, like Tier Element came out all at once.
But Tier was pretty late, though. Like...
Cash came out all at once, right?
Cash came out late. We didn't get it all at once either.
It was in two.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was two. There was another one that they did with. I just can't remember.
But I guess it is a different format as well. So like,
it's its own thing.
How's the goat thing as well? Is that still going?
Nah. Really enjoyable.
No, goat
it
thing
ended,
finished.
Though.
Yeah, we chatted about that last week. I think. If they may add that in as something you can do more often.
If it was permanent, that's all I would play.
Yeah.
No
goat tournaments here. It was such a big waste considering we've been playing it for a week. My brain is just ready to go, and we're playing Edison here.
So did the Time Wizard still kick off?
Yeah, no, it was all Edison. Yeah, they got 120 players for Edison.
Really good. Yeah,
that's really
I like that.
Moving over to the OCG, though, we have an announcement for an announcement of the ban list. So they have, again, alluded to the fact that they will be announcing the OCG ban list on the 24th, coming into effect on the 1st. It'll be interesting to see what they actually do for the OCG this time around. Do you think? Because
Snake Eyes is getting shot in the back of the head.
Yeah, I feel like they're just going to take that shit out.
It's Fire King, then Tempai, then Snake Eyes.
I think they're going to hit the Snake Eyes.
Yeah, they'll hit the Snake Eyes to stop Fire King.
I think they'll put Wanted to one, voices. And then they'll also hit the Snake Eyes as well.
They just ban Ash, right?
No, I think they'll put the Quick Play Spell to one, and then they'll probably put...
Yeah, because like three Witch with one Wanted seems kind of shit.
Yeah.
Kind of
odds on for Fire King, they're probably going to lose Kieran. Kieran will probably go
Kieran
to one.
Kieran to one. Yeah, that's exactly what I thought.
You just play one of the rest anyway.
But like, some lists don't even... some lists just play like two, because some like they don't even want to like open it. But like, it is still a good card.
To stop Fire King, you have to ban Fire King. That's the problem. So it'll be a case of whatever you can get out of the Snake Eyes package.
It is unfortunate, because like, I don't think... I know Kieran's a good card, but I don't think Fire King deserves to get hit. It's just Snake Eye that kind of just... amplify it so much.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be the first time that there's been casualties when you're trying to hit the meta.
That's true. Rip Hulk.
Come on.
Please.
Bring it back.
Absolutely not.
Will they do a voiceless sap?
In the SCG, no. Maybe.
No.
They might just do Divine and One just because.
Come on, they'll be like. There's a little. Divine and One.
It's OGD, they do weird stuff. Divine and One.
They could preemptively Divine and One just to handle other ritual decks in future.
But like, voiceless. Oh no, they're in OCG already got that new spell, right?
Yeah.
So they're already like full power still.
Full power still can't beat Viking.
No, they win some tournaments.
Some.
No. According to Ben, they lose all the time.
Well, they probably top
deck sucks.
I wish it lost all the time. I lost it one in the bloody main event.
I lost to both of them.
Is Saravis on the list in OCG? Or is it still three in OCG?
Oh, it's still three. That card's useless.
Hey. No, I thought like they would like put that to one.
Ooh, that's
Mares does not like light ritual decks.
This is it's getting very toasty.
This is why I'm now hunched forward.
We'll try and move it along. So we have an announcement for Worlds as well. So that's going to be taking place on the 7th and 8th of September in Seattle.
Seattle. We can go see Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan.
Yeah. And drop things off the Space Needle.
Toss salad, just cards. Scrambled
eggs. Is this the first time Worlds is in Japan?
Oh my god!
Just lit up?
Isn't Worlds always in Japan?
Blew into Frank.
Yeah, let's not ignore who that originally belongs to.
But yeah, that'll obviously cover the TCG, Duel Links, and Master Duel. Hope to see you there as a Master Duel player.
Right, so with Worlds, isn't it always in Japan?
No,
they generally alternate, so it's kind of like us in New Zealand. One year it'll be in Japan, US, Japan, another year it'll be somewhere else.
Okay, alright, fair.
Yeah, it used to do the whole global tour and then kind of in the... They did Japan pre-COVID, I think, and then post-COVID they just did Japan again.
Has Australia ever gotten or hosted Worlds?
No. We probably will never have it.
That's rough.
I mean, they don't like us enough to have a stream. I don't think they're going to give us Worlds.
True.
Also in the OCG, for the upcoming Quarter Century Chronicles sets, they've got some archetypes getting reprinted, which is hinted at potential support coming out for these archetypes. Good. Potentially not, though. It could just be the fact that they haven't reprinted them in a while.
What's the name of this pack? I haven't looked it up.
Quarter Century Chronicles side, Pride.
Pride, all right. Yeah, when we sat talking about 2 weeks ago, we remembered the first one, which I've now forgotten.
Unity.
I'm like, what was the other one? It was P. And I've been sitting there thinking, I'm like, I won't Google it. I'll just wait till Jake tells me.
It's in the brain somewhere. So the four archetypes are Medolce, Thunder Dragon, Magical Muskets, and...
Oh, Hunky Drew will be happy.
Drytron.
Oh my god.
I'm 2 out of 4, baby. Let's go. That's pretty fucked. That's pretty
still won't read them.
That's the thing. Like, they've been getting dribs and drabs here and there. And still...
The Drytron support we got with that last one was...
Very... I don't know, I like the idea of a free level 7 that you can just...
It does search the spells, which is cool.
Yeah, search the field spell that nobody plays.
Yeah, it ties in with the Asantic stuff. You can do like the combo.
Yeah, no one's doing that.
No one's doing that. It's very bad.
It's what you're meant to do.
You play like one of the worst bricks.
It's called the entire Exarctic deck.
No, I mean, if you just play that package in Drytron. No one's playing pure Exarctic. Exactly. No one's crazy enough to play Exarctic.
Actually, just quickly, on Master Duel the other day, I queued up against the Exarctic player. And I was like, oh god, I don't want to lose to this, but I don't know what any of them do. Oh no.
I won't lie, the Collector Rare Synchros look pretty nice.
Yeah, but that's just Collector Rare Synchros. Like, there could be any other Synchro and it'd be fine.
True.
You could go and buy boxes from the venue right now. They're still open. They'll sell them for $60 a pop.
Really? Only 60?
$60 a pop, that's it.
Their singles are like $10.
Their singles are less than $10.
Well, there you
Wait,
go.
Wait, but didn't that also have the Pankratops in there?
Yeah, it did.
Yeah. God, he was
and the Ogdoadics.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
And Pank's like $200 collector rare.
$60 a box.
I bought one and $200 Pank's.
Oh, you only had two Ultras. Oh.
Wait, that means there's a QCR in there somewhere. That's how that works.
Ooh. Four.
So, also in the OCG... Hang
on, said QCR.
Oh, hang on, my phone's mucked up.
It's quite good.
Stop.
Jake's ruining the news.
I would really love some Thunder Dragon.
Jesse got Collector Hungry Burger from the other box.
Oh, that's sick. I'll actually buy that off you.
What is it?
Collector Hungry Burger.
Oh, nice.
So we also have the V-Jump promos having been announced. There's two of them. The other one's not a V-Jump promo. Cross that. So it's a level 5 antique gear dragon. Oh, ancient gear dragon. Sorry, they're called antiques in the OCG? I didn't know this.
I don't know.
Yeah, apparently they're antique gears in OCG.
And what are they here? Ancient?
Ancient gears.
Oh, do we already have ancient gears?
Yeah, they're the same archetype, it's just a translation thing.
Yeah. I think that kind of works with Crowler's gimmick. Like, actually knowing that, that actually makes way more sense.
He's an antiquist.
Yeah.
So brag, ulti golems.
To the moon.
Surely.
Well, they're already
They're already super expensive.
They're already there.
Hopefully the fusion will go up.
So this one can't be special summoned. You can only use its second effect once per turn.
Wait. I want to... So at this exact moment, Ben has realized that Jake was making fun of Kurt last night for no reason. Because last night you were like, Kurt was like, but you have to normal summon it. And you were insisted. You were like, no, Kurt, just special summon it.
Are you done?
Is its first line of text, this card can't be special summoned. Are you done? You can tell me the rest of the card then.
Most of the ancient gear cards say ignoring its special summoning conditions because ancient gear golem is a piece of shit.
Apology video?
Get in the fucking bin! Anyway, so this one, it's summoning conditions. If
I ain't gonna read ancient gear cards.
If you decide to read what the ancient gear card says. So, if you control no monsters or monsters you control are earth machines, you can normal summon it without tribute.
Earth machine support.
When your opponent activates a spell, trap card, or effect, send one machine monster from your hand or face-up field or an ancient gear golem from your deck to the graveyard to negate that effect.
Oh wait, it makes you play the OG.
You don't have to, you can just send another machine.
Oh, okay, okay.
Just, if you want to do it from deck, you play the OG.
Yeah, okay, that's cool.
Yeah, it's not a bad little piece of support for an archetype that no one cares about.
I like
it. It's getting a lot of support this year.
It is getting a lot of support this
year. But remember the last time it got a lot of support?
Yeah, that went great.
Went great, everyone just bought the decks for Maxi. They had to put Maxi in the deck for people to buy it.
It's an Earth, that's synergy.
Yes, synergy.
So, before we've even seen OTS 24 here in Australia, we have the announcement of OTS 25 coming. We don't have a date as yet, however, we do have the first ulti as per norm. It is the head of Exodia.
I love it.
I hope they do a piece
each, sir. It doesn't make any sense.
I think it's a fantastic reprint.
I don't want to wait till the end of... I don't want to wait till like next year for the rest of that,
though. Yeah, we're going to get a piece every OTS
part. I don't mind if they do that, as long as the other two are, like, solid. Like Ash or something like that.
No,
like
just give... This is the solid piece.
Could they not do
no
a
Ash,
five...
just head.
Could they just not do a 5 ulti OTS?
That's what I actually thought
and
that.
Just have, and have the same... Like, and have the four other pieces be, like, 50% of it, and the 50 be the other.
The reason we're getting this is because we're getting all the Exodia support.
Yeah.
And I like that they're preemptively doing OTS prints this time instead of waiting until later to then do the print. So they've come out ahead of time. Like, we're not going to get the Exodia set for another 3 months? Mm-hmm. Maybe
yeah,
even,
so by the time
like,
it comes
5 months?
Out, it will all be, like,
we'll
maybe
have
one
the ulti in hand.
Oh, yeah,
yeah.
It's August.
Wait until Konami proves you wrong.
Eh.
At least if they do one at a time, it's easier to chase instead of chasing all five at once, like when the Starlights were released.
Yeah.
Which is cool. So like, you get the head, and then like, you know, then next set you work on like getting like the arm or leg, and then yeah. No, I think that's cool. If they do that, if they don't, then it's just trash. Because then you have one ulti piece, and then...
So speaking of the Exodia support coming out, we also have the announcement for the set that is coming in, the Infinite Forbidden. So it's going to be having its official release on the 17th of July.
So 4 months from now. We are definitely preempting this OTS back.
Yeah.
Again, I just can't see Konami actually doing what
they said. Oh yeah, so that pack will be, the August pack will be 2 weeks after that now. Yeah? No, a week after that. Oh my god.
What?
So Infinite Forbidden's in July.
Yep.
Yeah.
Huh.
Which is, it's a main set, so that is just NX main set.
Yeah.
So you have the... main set for Legacy of Destruction.
Yep.
That
is next month.
Yep.
And then July, Exodia.
Yeah, I thought it would be. Told me we went until August. That's
next,
right.
The next main set's going to be very nice.
I'm looking forward to doing Lightsworn Tings.
There's another July pack too, isn't there?
It's always like that.
Yeah.
And then we get the Mega Tins a month and a half later.
Yeah.
And then lastly on news, we have a bit of fun news coming to us from, I think it was Switzerland?
Oh, yes.
So yeah.
Sanrio collection.
Yeah, so for reasons I don't fully understand, McDonald's have partnered up with Konami and Hello Kitty, and bring us a bunch of Hello Kitty figures dressed up as Yu-Gi-Oh! Figures as McDonald's toys.
I think this is the greatest fucking thing in the history of 2024.
It is hilarious. So the Yu-Gi-Oh! Monsters that are featured are Dark Magician Girl, obviously, Obelisk Slifer and the Wind Dragon of Ra, Dark Magician, Blue Eyes, Karibo, Exodia, Time Wizard, and Red Eyes. Just all the staple OG cards.
Sure. Wing Dragon Rai, Hello Kitty wheels.
So many of them. Oh, I want so many of them that I just kind of want all of them.
I wonder, surely there'd be enough demand for people to chuck these on eBay.
Oh yeah, these will be on eBay for a shitload of money. Just like everything in Sweden.
Are these Swede, like,
it's all
Swedish
the same.
Exclusives? These not coming to
they're
the
just Norfies. They're not coming here, no.
Norfies, no. No, we won't get these. So moving on to
Belgium.
I can't remember what place it was.
Yeah.
This is the Belgium flag.
It could be Belgium,
on the release.
That's why they print all the Euro cards. So yeah.
It's Belgium. Still more Northies.
All Northies.
So moving on to some questions. If you weren't aware, we do have a Discord. Link will be in the description below. Feel free to jump in, say hi, and ask us questions. Our first question this week comes to us from Jesse. What's first? OTS Ulti Ash or... which Ash is getting first? Snake Eyes Ash or Ash Blossom?
Snake Eyes Ash.
The egg.
Probably.
If Ash Blossom was getting ulti, it would have been ages ago.
Yeah, it's too late now.
They already got the quarter century and then they thought ulti.
They already have an ulti. You don't need an OTS ulti.
Yeah, there's ulti in the rarity collection, so it's like...
Yeah, that's the same.
Yeah, same.
Yeah, it's...
Ulti.
I saw we didn't put a shout out for this as well. Like, there was no room in
we
the
we couldn't
set.
Find a place in the venue
couldn't
to record.
Find. Also, so I'm pretty sure most people have gone home.
Sweating on this balcony.
Yeah.
Next question is from Ryguy. What was it like when you first made the jump from casual to competitive decks? Do you have any advice for people looking to make that jump?
Well, once I was back seriously playing, when I made the jump from casual to competitive was when I picked up Totally Awesomes and had Paleo in Zoo format. That was great. My biggest advice would be learn the game first before you go and buy a deck. Otherwise, it is a waste of your money. And once you're ready, I'd wait for an next format to start. So once a ban list drops, see what the meta is looking like, and then go for it. Pick up your staples in the meantime, like if you Ash Blossoms, Imperms, anything you're going to need to throw in. And then when a format kicks into gear, if it's something that you want to do, go hard. But just make sure you lay the groundwork first. Otherwise, you're wasting your time and money.
I think it's good to also surround yourself with a group of people that actually do the similar thing.
Yeah.
Because it also helps with other testing, figure out what you want to play, and then also getting the cards you need and everything like that. Because doing it alone is quite overwhelming, depending on like what situation you're in.
Yeah.
So I think that's also good.
But yeah.
Yeah, that's fair.
I think researching what you're spending your money on is also really important. I know in my very early days, I was buying a lot of garbage product because like I could. But if I had my time back, like, and even just like buying and selling stuff, like there's so much stuff I wish I'd kept.
I bought so many shit decks just because I wanted to buy them.
I bought a lot of, what's the set the dangers came in?
Cyberstorm Access? No, that's too new. Cybernetic
something. I don't know. I was like just endlessly chasing those. And I didn't know much about the game because the first meta deck I played was like the Danger Thunder Dragon.
Cybernetic Overload?
Maybe. Also,
Cybernetic Horizons.
That's it, yeah. And I was just like endlessly like just buying like packs just to try and pull like Danger Nessies and stuff like that. So I kind of didn't really know what I was doing.
So, those cards ended up being like 50, 60 bucks. You could just.
Yeah, no, that's cards, the thing. Yeah. Like, I didn't know. I ended up just buying singles. And then, it's kind of like, I could have just saved so much more time.
I was the same. Like, I put aside, like, $600 for Striker when Striker came out, and then spent the $600 on boxes. Pulled one engage from six boxes.
Yeah,
rough times.
It was still fun opening product, but at the same time, once you know what you're doing, it's a bit easier.
Yeah.
You save a bit of money.
True.
Next question is from Paul Pelican. Sorry you weren't here this weekend, Paul. You had life things to do. At the YCS, what have you learned that you would do differently if the YCS was a week later? Could be deck techs or choices or preparation, etc.
I would have played the exact same deck that I played. I just would have tested it more. Like, the fact that I only decided to play this list a week ago is my downfall. They were...
Yeah, an extra egg with this list would have been nice. Yes.
Awkward OTK lines were the thing that I struggled with the most this weekend.
Figuring out stuff for Lullaby in other matches, like you could have gone a bit wider and gone...
I had all that sorted. Like I was like, Cashier, I'm just going to call Fenrir.
Yeah, true.
Make it work.
I would tell Jesse not to leave early. He's just been called for the public prize playoff.
Oh,
what, Jesse Hessel?
Yeah.
No.
Wait, what happened?
Oh, Jesse's been called for the public playoff.
If you enter a public event, you get called up by, like, randomly to play for a prize card.
And he got called
and he's not here.
Yeah.
Oh, dude.
That's so rough.
That's
well.
If someone's with Jesse, please record his reaction. Cause
he's driving home.
When did they call this?
Just then.
Just now.
Just now. Okay.
Yep.
The red runner, they call you as a replacement.
Does any red-headed guys with stretched ears?
You have to be in the room.
Go in.
Then answer the PA.
You get given a couple minutes grace if you're like nearby, but that's it.
Yeah. I wish I was another week to get like more prepared would have been nice, considering I wasn't really able to do much testing.
Yeah.
Especially with my side deck. My side deck just wasn't really, it was kind of just thrown together. Like, there's a lot of things I wish I had. Like, I really do wish I could play like droplets or just like kind of like a side deck of like board breakers, because as much as everyone said like it's a hand trap format, having them as well would have just really helped.
I think
for me personally, at least. But yeah.
Yeah, my side deck was also a bit garbo. That's probably something I'll change.
Like, there was a little bit of thought. Like, the beast seals were good. They didn't really come up, but like they were a good choice, I still think, because like voiceless and like branded. But I didn't verse any branded or voiceless, unfortunately.
Because I verse them all.
Yeah.
Live question typing. Next question is from Rygai. What are/were some of the best and worst formats for rogue decks?
Or tier. It's bad.
Yeah, tier was pretty cancer for rogue decks.
Tier was real bad for rogue.
Yeah. Because they just milled the rogue decks out. They were just like, you can't go if that's not your deck? Oh, what a pity. That's in your graveyard now. No. Sucks to be you, doesn't it? I put a card in your grave and you top your shift
one. Like, not the flu was rogue, but like, even if you milled like a couple of Rabinas or a statue off of flu.
Just milling like an M-Pen. Oh, you get M-Pen back, but like milling the Riser probably would hurt.
Yeah, if you hit too many of their level 7s, they just lose.
Yeah, yep. getting rid of the Avion would have been pretty rough as well. TKF.
What were some of the best formats for Rogue though?
This format.
To a point.
In my opinion, that's the point. Not like the best ever, but I think it was very solid.
Like, weirdly, Zoo was a decent format for Rogue, just because you could put Zoo into literally anything.
Yeah, but then if it has Zoo in it, is it still counted as Rogue?
I don't know. Ask Zoo Infernoid.
Maybe like before Zeus was printed.
Yeah. Zeus just is kind of shit on Rogue pretty badly.
Yeah. Zeus Turbo is kind of like...
That's a nice board you've got there. Oh, Zeus. What a pity it's gone.
Attack directly with Bulbo, Zeus.
You mean your deck doesn't have recovery built in? Sucks to suck.
Anyway. also from Rygai, how do you pick which decks you want to play out of upcoming sets? Is it based off interest, ability, or maybe something else?
It's about how much shit I talk about it and whether or not I want to try and actually make it work. Like, I'll be real, I joked about Goblin Bikers being good. I'm going to play it for probably the next month.
Yeah.
I talked mad shit about how Rescue Ace was going to be great. Look where we are now, baby.
I mean, you also talked about Unchained not doing...
No, like, when it came out. What?
Yeah, I mean, you talked mad shit about Unchained...
No, but I didn't intentionally say it was good, despite the fact that it very clearly was not.
I do like how Unchained get that, like, kind of, like, refreshment. It was, like, kind of just dead for so long, and then just kind of became, like, tier one.
Well, the thing, and again, I've said this so many times with Unchained, like, its play was so heavily telegraphed that, like, anyone could break it. It's like, I'm gonna link your stuff.
Makes an anima.
It was
like
nice.
The release of the ability to get to an Xe that stops specials, the recursion from grave, and SP also being released at the same time was just like perfect for that deck. And Maxi not being in the format, because it would suck to Maxi.
The link, I think the link is really solid.
Link's real good.
It was very nice. Like, even though the dog got limited one, like, I still think the Link is just so good to keep it going.
Thrust being an extender as well is also bonkers. Like, yeah. Most decks is like, oh, set, imperm, yeah. Hope for the best.
There.
Last question. Sorry, I forgot what I was doing for a minute. Last question comes to us from 6i6 again. What is your best shirt / costume / outfit you saw at this year's YCS?
What I'm wearing right now, baby.
Shout out to Scrap Kong shirts. It's good to see that. I don't know what the meaning behind their Scrap Kongs are, but I'm a Scrap
what
man.
What was
so.
The... I don't know what it was, but some guy with like a mask and a top hat.
Nah. He's Card Trader.
Oh, Card Trader. Yeah.
He wore it for 3 days straight. I'm sure today that outfit smells pretty bad.
It was cool.
The Ajama Yellow was pretty funny. That was cool.
Ajama Yellow was pretty good.
Was yep. Oh, I seen that, yeah.
Yeah. A bit cursed, but...
I thought it looked like a bumblebee.
A bit.
I was like, ah! Every time was a jump scare. I turned to go, ah!
And what was it? That's what the Ajama should be, really.
What was the other person that kind of looked like the Joker?
He has the main mask on. And
he does that all the time.
He does that every year.
That's
he had a sign.
He came dead last, and I think it was on purpose.
Yes. Play self 50k.
Okay. There was only those three, right?
Good for supporting the game.
I hope he lives nearby. I'm sorry it
doesn't live too far away at all.
Okay. Because otherwise it'd be so expensive to come here and literally put yourself last just for the meme value.
Yeah. Imagine, or like it's training like here while wearing something like that. I would not wear that on a train.
No, absolutely not.
I mean, like, I imagine he has a few people he knows as well. Like, there's a few people like I like seeing and having a chat with.
Yeah.
Talk to them once a year.
They seem like nice people.
If I bump into him at a region, I always say hello.
Yeah.
He wasn't in makeup today.
That's probably why I didn't recognise him. I think I've legitimately only seen him outside, like, in costume.
I waved and he wasn't paying attention.
you say that.
Yeah.
He unsubscribed.
Rude.
That concludes us for today. Thank you all very much for listening and watching. If you are listening along, feel free to favourite. If you are on YouTube, like and subscribe. Jump into a Discord, ask us some questions next week, and we'll catch you all then. Peace from YCS.
See ya.
Bye.